Hi, my name is Tara, and I'm a Senior Technical Product Manager with the Cloud and Enterprise Data Division. Today, we are here to talk about how to develop applications using SQL Server on Linux, Entity Framework, Azure, and DevOps. As you could see, most of the key features of SQL Server 2016 are included in SQL Server on Linux, such as the new security features, per se, transparent data encryption, always encrypted, row-level security, and also the advanced features like in-memory tables, column store, and more. Functionality that you would expect to be there will be there. Full-text search, SQL Server agent, replication, and more. Microsoft and third-party tools running on Windows work just fine when connected to SQL Server on Linux. And the best part, we have native command line tools for Linux too. All your applications written in various languages like C#, C++, Java, Python, Node, PHP, and more just work fine when connected to SQL Server on Linux. In short, this is the same SQL Server you know, but now it's native to Linux. All right, before we jump into the demo, I want to show you quickly the schematics. As you can see, this is a microservices architecture, and the customer-facing applications are all pointing to Azure SQL Database. About the scenario, bike sharing 360 is expanding at a rapid pace. And one of the criteria for bike sharing 360's success is to validate the compliance and performance of the hosted application. To do so, they wish to test the application in-house. Let's take a close look at how bike sharing 360 business is developing the application for achieving higher scale and security through this demo. As mentioned, to test the application in-house, bike sharing 360 has chosen Linux and SQL Server as the platform for local development. We have a SQL container with the application database for bike sharing 360 pre-installed, as you see on your screen. You can also install SQL Server on a Linux in a VM in less than 60 seconds on bare metal or in a Docker container, as you would have seen in one of the earlier videos in the series. All right, let me show you what I've done here. I have git cloned the complete repo for bike sharing 360 to my local environment, and I'm using VS Code to develop and deploy this application. If you notice carefully, the code is based on Entity Framework, that is an object relational mapper that enables .NET developers to work with relational data using domain-specific objects. It eliminates the need for most of the data access code that developers usually need to write. Okay, let's go ahead and run the application. I'm going back to my terminal, and I'm just going to go and run my application right here. Now, as you could see, that I'm running this application on my local host and my database is bike sharing writes in memory. Okay, there's certain challenges which bike sharing 360 is facing at the moment. The widget for showing the total trip distance in the app is slowing down the load time of the home page. We want to test this out using a REST API client. All right, let me just go ahead and pull the REST API client up. I'm going to click on API writes distance. And what it's internally doing is it's executing a T-SQL query that calculates the total distance traveled by all bike riders so far. Since the data is huge, this calculation takes a while. Let's go run this. Okay, so we took around 3 seconds, right? Let's also look at the details here. And if you would see here, the wait time is around that much, right? So we waited a long time to make that connection. I think for being more realistic, let's run this again so the data is now in the cache and we should see a better result against the database in the table when we run this query. That's more realistic. So we took around 477 milliseconds to run this particular query, and the total distance has now been calculated. And as you can see, this is an analytical query and it needs some of the analytical processing in the backend. Okay, now, as we saw, this took a bit of a while. The question is, how do we solve this challenge? Let me show you some cool stuff. Per the analysis we have been doing on how we can make it better, and let me just minimize these windows quickly, we figured out that in-memory could be a great option for us to resolve the query performance time. We can fix the slow query time by making the writes table an in-memory table in SQL Server, and also by adding clustered columns to index, since the query, which we just saw, is an analytical query, and the write distance column is a numerical column, and we want to do a sum on it. Great candidate for CCI, or columns to index. The great news is that I wrote the code in Entity Framework that makes enabling in-memory super, super easy. Just a single line of code and we have the tables in memory. Let's do that. So right here, that's it. And once you run this application, the tables are gonna be in memory. To save time in this particular demo, we have already migrated the table to in memory, but this is exactly what you need to do behind the scene in your code to get this table into memory. All right, let's go back into the application and run that app once again. So I'm gonna stop this, clear this out a bit. I'm gonna run this again. And we're gonna do the same thing we did just with the disk space tables. So let's go back to the REST API client and see how much difference it has made since we have added in memory and columns to index to this writes table. So I'm gonna go and pick up the write API we're gonna be using here, and we're gonna do the same thing. So first run, certainly it's gonna take a while, but still around 2.5 seconds. And we waited on making the connection. So the realistic picture will be once we run this query once again, or call the REST API client against the table once again. Look at that, 28 milliseconds, almost 20 to 30 times faster performance compared to what we got on this base table. Awesome, isn't it? Now this is the wow factor. What we need to still do here is the second part of the puzzle, right? And solve that. The second part of the puzzle or the challenge here is we have some security concerns. Let's go and look at the security concern from this REST API again, as the application is running. Every time the customer uses the application, they have to kind of go through a customer profiling. We have a profiles API, and we want to check how their data looks like when it comes to the database. So let's have a look at that. And as you could see, the data is shown in clear text. Now there are some great opportunities here for us to create some or add some features like always encrypted, which keeps your data at rest, at transit, secure. But also at the application layer, there are concepts or technologies and features like dynamic data masking, row-level security, which is available to you today on SQL Server on Linux. Let's pick one of them. I just want to go and mask the email addresses of all these customers because I think that's not compliant with the business requirements of bike sharing 360. How do we do this? It's super simple. Let's go back to Visual Studio Code, and we'll keep the application running as is. And we have dynamic data masking.sql statement. And how do you enable this? You alter the table profiles, and then you alter the column email, and we already have an inbuilt function, and there are some partial functions as well. For this particular scenario, it's email. Let's go and run this. Best part with Visual Studio Code, you have the Visual Studio SQL extensions and you can run the query right from Visual Studio Code. So I'm just gonna go and run this against the in-memory tables database. And that should run the query, which is awesome. Let's go back to that REST API client. As you can see, I'm not rerunning the app or there's no change I have to do on the application layer itself. I'm just gonna go and run this query once again. And voila. Have a look at that. Beautiful. Now I've got the email field masked. And there could be different fields depending on what is considered as PII information for the organization. And you can mask the data set based on that. Great. Now that I've done so much, the next thing we want to do here is to achieve and deploy this whole application changes to my production, right? Now that I'm pretty happy with the application, let's deploy this application to a staging environment in the cloud. The first step is to generate Entity Framework migration script. Let me show you how to do that. So we're going to come back to the terminal. I'm just going to go and stop the application, clear this out a bit, and we're going to run .NET EF migration script SQL/migrate.sql. This is going to create the complete migration script we need to be deployed to our production or staging environments. Okay, once I run this, now you could see migrate.sql shows up here in my lists here, right? So let's have a close look at this quickly. Let me just close one or two of these windows. Don't save, that's fine. All right, now if you see this, this is the complete migration script with, you know, DDM or dynamic data masking, in-memory, and CCI, right? We're pretty much good to go and migrate this to our SQL Server in the cloud, or I should say SQL database in the cloud. But before that, we need to go commit this to our VSTS repo, right? So let's go back and look at our Git repo here. And as you could see that the changes are now showing up. I'm just gonna go and push a commit. And that'll just enable my CI/CD pipeline or my DevOps pipeline, and that'll start implementing those changes back into my production. Now, before we go live, there's one thing I want to test, and that is to ensure that my staging looks perfectly fine, right, with the changes we have made. So let's go and do some quick checks here. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to go and export my ASP netcore underscore environment to stage. And I'm going to run this application once again. And now you would see that this is connecting to my Azure SQL database back in the cloud, right? Just a flip of connection string and we're pretty much good to go and test our application. So let's just ensure that this works. I'm just going to go back to that same REST API client and I'm going to run this query, or I should just invoke this REST API again and see if the data shows up exactly the way it is showing up now, which means the dynamic data masking is enabled, in memory is in the loop, and columnstore index as well. But let's just test one of the features. So let's go and send this query. And look at that, beautiful. So even in the cloud, the same data set, same dynamic data masking is applicable. So whether you are on SQL Server on Linux, SQL Server on Windows, SQL DB in the cloud, the code base is just the same. You don't make application changes, but every single change you make on one single SQL technology, it just kind of replicates across, right? Beautiful. Okay, so in a short while, we saw three very major things. One, how entity frameworks works with SQL Server on Linux. Second, how do you enable advanced features into the application? And third, how by changing a single flip of the connection string, your data is still the same and the changes you made are still showing up in the cloud. All right, so you just saw how we develop applications using Entity Framework, SQL Server on Linux, DevOps, and Azure. Go and git clone the following repositories. And if you wish to know more about SQL Server on Linux, go to our landing page. Thank you so much for watching. Have a good day.